So, you know, as we will see in more detail in this class, there is some effective potential motion happening. So, the planet in the R direction goes from maximum to maximum and comes back. Okay, so we'll see this in more detail in this class. So we wanted to know how much does phi change? How much does phi change as it undergoes this motion? Okay? And in order to get that, what we did was take this equation and say that delta phi is equal to this object del s r by del m integrated over r over a whole lot. A whole oscillation in infinite motion. Right? And then we did a change of variables in this equation. If I remember right, to the order at which we were working, we said r prime is equal to r minus r g by 2. Okay, the point of this change of variables was that to the order at which we were working, this changed, firstly, there was no change in the integration measure. Dr was dr. So this didn't change. Okay, secondly, to the order at which we were working, this made this object, let's see, there was the m dependency of the n squared into r into r minus r of g. Right? And so, if we write r as r minus r prime minus r, if r minus rg by 2 is r prime, then this is m squared divided by r prime plus rg by 2 into r prime minus rg by 2. Okay? And the linear terminology goes away. So, up to linear order, this is m squared over r prime squared. So that change of variables made the m dependence in the problem n squared divided by r prime squared. The m dependence is crucial because it's the differentiation with respect to m that gives you the order. Okay? So to the order at which we were, working, this change of variables made the m dependence inside the action m squared by r prime squared. And then we kept track of what it did to the rest of the to the rest of the radial part of the action, and part of it was just giving you a constant which was a renormalized energy, and the renormalized 1 by r, the renormalized Newton force. But there was an important other term, which was a renormalized 1 by r squared. I mean, not a renormalized 1 by r squared, but a new 1 by r squared. A 1 by r squared piece where there would have been none in Newtonian mechanics. Okay? So, ignoring the, you see, the renormalization of the constant of the 1 by r squared piece gives you a small renormalization of the parameters of the ellipse, but retains an ellipse. You know, this equation here, phi is equal to del s r by del n, would be the equation of an ellipse for any integral of the sort constant plus 1 by r plus n squared by r squared. The parameters of the ellipse depend on what the constant is and what the 1 by r piece is, but it gives you an ellipse. But it's the 1 over r squared piece in the action that is not associated with n squared that gives you the precision. Changes this orbit from being a closed orbit to one that persists. Okay? And then they use some clever techniques to compute how much the angle changed in a single orbit. Okay? The idea was that, look, the change of angle in an orbit was this much. Okay? But we know that if we don't take into account the general relativistic correction, that change in angle is too high. This is something we've studied in our last course. Okay? So what we're interested in is the change in this change of angle. Okay? Because of the Newton. And then we used the fact that the new term appeared like a renormalization of the angular momentum. Okay? To very, very cleverly compute this change in the change of angle without ever doing an integral. Because we get what was the change of anger. We got what was a derivative with respect to M in the unperturbed portion. But that derivative we knew gave us a 2 pi. And then all that was left over was a change in what was the effective shift? What was the effective shift in M, which we computed from this procedure? Okay, I'm just trying to remind you of what we did. Just to jog your memory enough to ask if you have any questions or comments. Okay, and when we went through this procedure, in the end we got some shift in angle. I can quote you the result if you want. And this is this famous shift in angle that agreed with the shift in the position of the variable, you know, mercury. We got this delta phi is equal to 6 pi k. I suppose mass of the sun over maybe you wrote it 6 pi k squared m squared I squared by c squared m squared. So there are two masses, one is the mass of the sun, the other is mass of the body. And that was the angular moment. Not only 50 factors of C squared, consistently popular. Restored the image. Okay. So any questions or comments about this? We're going to continue our study of motion in the central force problem. Unless you have questions. Delta phi is this. This is because phi, as a function of r, is given by this equation. Okay? So now suppose we've got some radial motion. As we will see, it's radial motion, some sort of effective potential. That's very true. Okay, so what we want to know is how much has phi changed as we have undergone this radial motion. So since phi is given as a function of r by this equation, the change in phi is integrating, is given by integrating over 1 of is that clear? So phi, so what is the change in phi? It means the value of the function, the first value of r, minus the value of the function in the second value. Okay. So now, of course, this is a multi-value kind of thing. So you do this, see how much phi changes, and you do that, see how much changes. Yep. Excellent. Okay. Excellent. So now what we want to do is 2-3 more things about this central force problem. The first thing I want to do is to, so far what we've done is to study motion that was almost Newtonian. We've looked at small corrections about Newtonian motion. And of course that was very important for experimental tests. Okay? But, you know, when you've got a completely new theory, it's important to make contact with the old theory. But it's most interesting to ask about a completely new phenomenon. Okay? So, now we're going to ask, suppose we look at motion that is very far from Newton. What phenomena do we see in the center of it? Okay? So we're going to once again use this this effective action. And of course, for any particular motion, you can integrate these equations, perhaps even numerically, or using elliptic functions. But what we're more interested in than any particular motion is the net, is the qualitative features. Okay. So the first thing we're going to do is to try to write, you know, try to massage this formula into a form so that we can apply some Newtonian intuition to it. Okay. So how do we find from this formula what r as a function of time is? Somebody, what do we do together to this action? With respect to what? Good, good. What is the basic equation of the Hamilton-Jacobi triangle? Once you've got the action, what do you do to find orbits, to find trajectories? The action is written as a function of new momentum. Hamiltonian in the new coordinates vanishes. Therefore, new coordinates are also constants. Like a time derivative with respect to the new momenta angles. Okay? So the basic equation of motion in the Anderson-Jacobi framework is generated by taking this the whole action and differentiating with respect to E, which is one of the new momenta. These are the integration constants, right? This and this, the two integration constants. The rule is, take the action, differentiate with respect to the integration constants, and set what you get to equal to zero. Okay? So that's what we're going to do. What we're going to do is to take this object and differentiate with respect to E. Now, here when we differentiate with respect to E, we get minus T. And here when we differentiate with respect to E, we get what? We get E divided by 1 minus R G by R n squared divided by square root. E squared divided by 1 minus R G by R. See, something I should say is the following. We're using this Hamilton-Jacobi method because it's the most elegant thing we've done. Okay? It's not necessary. In fact, I'll give you a problem in the new problem set, in which I'll ask you to derive many of these results using more elementary techniques. So you should, if you find Hamilton-Jacobi confusing because you've more or less forgotten it, you should let that confusion make you think general relativity is complicated. Okay? These are two separate things. Okay, minus m squared by r squared plus m squared by 1 minus r g by r. Okay, so I'm trying to follow this method because it's sort of nice, it gives you practice and habit. And it's really the fastest way to the answer. But, once again, what we have to do in principle is quite clear. You find the equations of motion for this particle. Do you know I'm trying to write on the GDC? And solve that, if you apply that. It'll always give you the same answer. Okay. So anyway, so this is the equation of the act. Which is your obvious function of t. Now, for any particular initial condition you plug in here, that's what you do the orbit. But we're not interested in a particular orbit, we want general features. So what I'm going to do is unintegrate this partly. You see, what this equation is really saying, where did it come from? Well, what this equation is really saying is minus vt by dr. Will that be a minus sign?
Minus.
Say again, but
minus t plus delta
is minus. Thank you. So this is what this equation is really telling you is that dt by dr is equal to integral e to, well, no integral. So we differentiate both sides. Okay. So e divided by 1 minus r g by r. Square divided by the square. Okay? So. What?
There's
RDL. No, there's no one. That was nothing. Okay? So now we can take this and take square root square is equal to. E squared by 1 minus r g by r, the whole thing, to the fourth, dr by dt, the whole thing squared. Okay? So we get, okay, now this square root has these, the square root has these denominators of 1 minus rg by r the whole thing squared. So we benefit by taking two of these values. Okay, so let's write it. So what we get e squared dr by dt the whole thing squared is equal to what? So it's equal to this business, it's equal to 1 minus rg by r the whole thing squared into this stuff with the denominators. Into e squared minus m squared by r squared plus m squared into 1 minus r squared. Okay? You see, now this equation is very much like an equation in, let me just check about it. formula that it assumes. Okay. Okay, good. Now, you see, this sign here is like the kinetic energy of a particle. Okay? So, if we think of E squared by, well, E squared as twice the mass, if we think of E squared as equal to twice the effective mass, that's what M vector, then this is of the, this equation is of the form kinetic energy is equal to some function of R. Okay? So this function of R could be thought of as minus the potential for zero energy motion. So suppose you had motion in a potential, this is equal to minus V of R. Okay? And E squared was twice M effective. Then this would be the motion of a particle moving with E effective, so energy E effective equals zero, moving in this potential. No, it's just that we're studying this equation. So what I'm saying is that, look, in Newtonian mechanics,
Real
things, no. I'm just trying to make connections with these, with our Newtonian intuition. I'm saying, suppose we had the one-dimensional motion of a Newtonian particle within a potential V of R, V of X. Okay. So then, by conservation of energy, we would get M X dot squared by 2 minus V of, plus V of X is equal to the conserved energy. So suppose we were looking at a fictitious particle, just a fictitious mathematical particle, where we got a particle of mass E squared by 2, just for that mathematics. It's not really on the mass plane, okay? And it was moving with energy zero in the potential, this potential, such that this was minus V of R. Then we would get exactly the same motion. Is this clear? Thank you. Okay. So, now we can use our general Newtonian intuition for zero energy motion for this effective potential. Okay? So we can think of turning points and, you know, oscillations and so on, all of that. Just understand the qualitative nature of the motion quite easily in pictures, once we understand how this effective potential behaves. Okay? Now the most important part. Okay, so this effective potential has two pieces. It has this 1 minus RG by R squared into something. Now the most important things about this potential are going to be, you know, its zeros. You see, because we're looking at zero energy motion. So let's see. So what we're doing, we've got some energy E here, and we've got a potential. And if this potential behaves something like this, then we get bound state motion doing this. Okay? So clearly the zeros of this potential are really distinguished objects. Okay? Now as far as zeros go, as long as motion is not going to go towards the Schwarzschild radius, R equals RG, the zeros of this object are the same as the zeros without this multiplier. Okay? So the first thing that we're going to do is to understand just diagrammatically how this object behaves. Okay? Now this object is pretty simple, because it's E squared minus something else squared. So the first term is just a constant piece, just some constant E squared. So in order to understand how the object that I've circled behaves, we're going to understand first how this object behaves. Okay? This object is sometimes called U. the effective R squared. And the circle green guy goes to zero when U effective squared becomes E squared, or where U effective is equal to E. So the points where U effective is equal to E is going to be a distinguished role in that analysis. Okay? So now for the next 10 minutes, what we're going to do is look at this U effective squared as a function of R and try to understand what kind of function it is, just as a mathematical problem. Then we'll come back and use that understanding to understand what center force motion in this manner. Okay? So let's write that down. Okay. So U effective squared. I mean, what about it? Just not U effective squared, but effective. It's simple. We have that is equal to m squared by r squared plus m squared. Into 1 minus r g. Okay. Now, this is a potential. So let's say r g. You know, r g is, as far as this problem is going, setting the state. You can even think of it as well. R equals r g is a distinguished point. But other than r g, there's one, well, then there's some over, you know, it's this ratio of m's, little m squared by capital N squared, that's going to set one other parameter. Okay? So really, it's the ratio of m squared or g squared by m squared, little n squared, that's an effective parameter. Is this clear? By scaling r away, I can remove rg from the problem. But that will put an rg squared here. And then there's an overall constant outside. But there's this effective ratio, capital M squared by rg squared, little m squared. Effective, pull little m squared. Okay? So there's effectively a one parameter set of effective potentials here, parameterized by this one parameter, capital M squared by rg squared, little m squared. Okay? So this effective potential could behave quite differently, depending on what this one parameter is doing. Okay. So, let's first, before starting with quantitative analysis, let's first just look at this effective potential. So first, let's look at two limits. Let's first look at this parameter is 0. When this parameter is 0, that's capital M equals 0. It's a very simple effective potential. It's a constant times 1 minus R divided by R. Okay? So let's see. Okay. So the scaling that I talked about, I'm going to do it in advance, isn't it? So let's look at U effective squared divided by capital N squared. Okay? And let me define the variable R divided by R G is equal to X. Okay. Then let us see. So what we get is m squared by little m squared rg squared 1 by x squared plus 1 into g minus 1. Is this clear? This makes it clear that this is the only parameter. Okay? Now, so let me plot this u effective squared by n squared on the y-axis, and x, which is rg divided by rg, r units of the short unit radius on the x-axis. Okay? So let's first look at this guy being 0. Then this is just 1 minus 1 by x. Okay? So if we start plotting at x equals 1, we don't want to plot for x less than 1 because the funny things associated with this guy. Okay? So we trust physically trust these plots for this. Okay? So we start plotting, of course we could plot. Okay? We start plotting at x equals 1, it's 0, and then it asymptotes to 1 from middle. This is what we're talking about. This gap. X. look at another limit. Next, let's look at the limit. In which this parameter is very, very large. Okay, so now what happens when this parameter is very, very large? When this parameter is very large, we have to go to very large values of x before this becomes relevant at all. Right? So if this parameter I call alpha, for x squared much, much less than alpha, and alpha is very large, you can just forget about the 1. Okay? So, in that region, this is just alpha divided by x squared multiplied by something like that. Okay? If x is reasonably large, okay. If x is also reasonably large, we can forget about this term. This is just like a 1 by x squared form. So the potential comes down like this. However, when x becomes much larger than alpha, then you can forget about this term compared to this term. And then we have the same approach to 1 from below that we saw before. Okay? So if we draw 1 here, it's clear this curve has to come somewhere. Okay? And then approach it this. Okay? Also, at x equals 1, the whole thing is 0. So it's clear that qualitatively the curve is. Depending on what this parameter is, we get two rather different kinds of behaviors. The first behavior is just monotonic increase to 1. The second behavior is bump up, come down, and then approach 1 from below. Now we're going to do this more quantitatively. But before we do that, let's look at the physical implications of these two different kinds of behaviors. You see, firstly, suppose we plotted, you see, what we were interested in was that whole circle thing being equal to 0. That is the same as this potential being equal to E squared, remember? Okay? So, what we would like to put is a line of this potential is equal to E squared, or this potential divided by M squared is equal to E squared by M squared, somewhere on this graph. Okay, so suppose we did that on this graph here, and it went like this. Then we could have a nice stable orbit. Okay, this has a minimum. Okay, we could also have circular orbit if E exactly touched. It would be a stable circuit. On the other hand, here there's also an unstable circuit on it. That's some other value. It would be there, nice and circular, but any little perturbation would destroy it. Okay? So, this kind of potential here has both stable circular or stable like circular orbits, if you would look at it, and also has unstable circular. Well, this kind of potential here has no extremum at all. So it just has no circular orbits. Okay? If we have this kind of potential, we just fall. Whoosh. Okay? Or maybe escape. But you can't stay steady. No, it's not some steady orbit. Okay? Whereas, with this kind of potential, we have the ability to orbit in a steady way. Is this clear? Okay. So, we're now going to make all this more quantitative. We're going to try to understand this.
Small n is the particle.
Small n is the particle.
Why is it dependent?
Well, because angular momentum depends on. So, if you expressed it in terms of just velocities, velocity data loop. Angular momentum second time. Yes.
In this second case, what, I don't visualize motion with 3 points intersecting the curve. Does that matter?
Well, with 3 points intersecting the curve?
Yeah.
Yeah. Basically, in this case, there's a barrier. So there are two possible kinds of motion.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
You could have had a motion in which something came from. Okay. So the second, in this case, suppose it's like this. At this energy, there are two kinds of motion. One kind of motion is just this. So another kind of motion is that the particle comes out of the black hole, reaches a finite maximum distance, goes back into the black hole. At the same energy, both things are possible.
So what about those two intersections, the first two intersections?
Sorry. This and this?
Yes, yes.
Okay. This one doesn't intersect any. I'm sorry, where was one? Let me draw this curve a little more precisely. So, let's say one was this line. Let's suppose that one is this line. Let me draw the curve. Okay, so this is one. I'm going to draw it. Okay. So then this thing does this. Okay. Now, depending on whether your energy is greater than the green line or less than the green line. Okay. Okay, suppose we've got energies less than green line. Okay, then we've got a stable orbital.
So what about the third point?
This point?
Yeah, this and that.
Okay, so let's take two possibilities. There's this, and there's this. Okay, so in this case where energy is smaller than the particle has at infinity with diameter. Okay, so you can have a bound state. But you can also have the particle emerging from the black hole, going to a maximum distance, and going back.
Yeah.
Okay? At this point, where the energy is larger than the particle would have at infinity. You know, so this is going to be like positive energy for the Newtonian. Okay? So you just go zooming off there. Or again, you could have particle coming out of the black hole. Now there's a third energy. Let's see. If a particle was shot out of the black hole, however something shot out of the black hole, okay? If the particle was shot out of a black hole with that energy, it'll go all the way to infinity. Is this clear? Okay. Well, is that possible? We'll be Hawking radiation. We'll talk about such things. Okay. But let's get a little more quantitative about this before we begin. Okay, so the thing I want to do is to understand these curves better. In particular, I want to understand, at what value of this parameter this potential makes a transition between this kind of behavior and this kind of behavior. Okay, so it looks like it would be a good idea to study the derivative of this potential, because the distinguishing feature of this potential is that its derivative nowhere vanishes. Whereas here, its derivative vanishes in 2 minutes. So when you first start having solutions to vanishing of derivative of this potential, that's going to be the two solutions, of course, will merge. This minimum and maximum will merge when they first will be a point of inflection. Okay? And that's going to give you the distinguishing, the dividing line between these two behaviors. Okay? So let's. So let's compute the derivative of this potential. So the derivative of this potential is what? So let's call this whole thing alpha as we have. Yeah? So that's alpha divided by x squared. I'm just writing down the potential first. Minus alpha by x cubed plus 1 minus 1 by x. That's the potential. Okay? Let's differentiate it. So differentiating it gives minus 2 alpha by x cubed. Plus 3 alpha by x to the fourth, 1 is the derivative, and plus 1 by x. Okay. I want to solve the equation that this is equal to 0. This is the plenty of common powers of x, that is the thing of x squared, x squared. So I've got a quadratic equation. So let me multiply it by x squared. So x here, x squared here. I'm going to solve for this. You're probably equal to that. Okay? And now you will help me get this right. So, where is it? X is equal to minus 2, minus 6, plus minus, sorry, 6, up. No, no, sorry. Plus 4, plus minus b squared, so that's 2 alpha over b squared, minus 4 is minus 12, 4 2 a, so
minus 12 alpha.
What? What? Say it.
Minus 12 alpha.
Minus 12, thank you. Minus 12 alpha. Thank you. Okay? So let's cancel the 2 in the denominator.
That's 2 alpha.
That's my x squared.
That's
2
alpha.
Thank you. Okay, so we get alpha plus minus alpha squared minus 3 alpha as our solutions. Excellent. So first question. When do we have solutions to this equation? Clearly, okay. Yeah, alpha. Sorry, we should remember what alpha. Alpha was equal to n squared by
r t squared.
Okay. So clearly, we only have solutions to the equations. Have solutions. Borderline between these two behaviors. When alpha is less than 3, the graph looks like the first one, the monotonic increments. When alpha is greater than 3, the graph looks like the second guy. Whoop, whoop. Okay. Now, in order to get a better sense of the physics, let's study the circular orbits that exist when alpha is greater than 3. Okay? So when alpha is greater than 3, we just determined the value of r divided by rg at the points where the derivatives vanish. Okay? So, you see, okay. So, so there are two possible values. There's the smaller value, which will be the unstable guy, and the larger value, which will be the stable guy. Okay? Now, what is the smallest possibility for the larger value? Okay? So, for stable, x stable is equal to alpha plus the larger guy.
Alpha squared minus 3 alpha.
Okay? Now, when is this this function minimum? And what value of alpha is it? Okay. So clearly it doesn't even exist for alpha less than 3. And then when alpha increases to be greater than 3, this thing just increases. So alpha equals 3 is when it's minimum. Okay? So, x stable is min at alpha equals 3. And when that's the case, this square root is 0. So at that point, x stable is equal to 3. What have we concluded? We have already concluded something that's very important. We've concluded that stable circular orbits in this Schwarzschild background do not exist for r less than 3 times the Schwarzschild radius. The minimum value of x on a stable circular orbit, okay, occurs at r is equal to 3 times the Schwarzschild radius. You know, this fact is dramatically seen in astrophysical experiments, in observations of black holes. One of the ways you see a black hole is this. You see this, there's an actual black hole somewhere, right? And it's pulling in matter. So there's this matter swirling into the black hole in this big accretion disk. And this accretion disk is, of course, solving the equation of fluid dynamics. But it's not too bad an approximation to think of all the fluid forces being a small perturbation. Roughly speaking, each of the particles, I mean, just the crudest zeroth approximation, each of the particles is just moving along a GMS. Okay? So, you've got this accretion disk, and then when you look at this black hole, you suddenly see a big hole in that accretion disk. It's because these particles are moving in roughly stable circular orbits and slowly losing energy due to dissipation, going to smaller and smaller circular orbits. Suddenly they go to 3 times RT. And then there's no stable circular orbit for them to be, and they just whoosh, spiral into it. So you see this accretion disk with the hole. This is a phenomenon that is just not there in Newtonian gravity. And every value of the distance from the sun, you have circular, stable circular orbits. In general relativity, you do not have stable circular orbits for a Schwarzschild black hole at less than 3 times the Schwarzschild. And this is a fact that is plausibly observationally seen. Okay. Now, please.
Is gravity changing for what?
Well, for massless particles living in it. We'll study that. Yes. Now, the next question that we're going to ask. Is what about the unstable circuit? Do we have unstable circular orbits all the way? You see, it's clear from this graph that you have unstable circular orbits at smaller values than you have circular orbits. Okay? So let's study x unstable. So that's an unstable. Okay. And so that is alpha minus square root of, so let's take the alpha out. 1 minus 3 by alpha. Okay. Now, where is this function its min at? You might think alpha equals 0, but that's nonsense. Because this square root doesn't exist as a real number. Remember, it starts at alpha equals 3. Okay? And alpha equals 3. X unstable and x stable are the same values. Okay? But you see from this graph that this guy moves to the left and that guy moves to the right. As you move away from it. Okay? So it's actually the you can convince yourself that it's quite easily. It's actually the other end. Maybe alpha equals infinity, but this guy takes it to infinity. Okay? Now, what is the value of this x unstable? When alpha is equal to infinity. Okay? You might think, well, it's equal. That's not right. It's alpha minus alpha, but because this is small, we'll expand it into this. 1 minus 3 by 2 alpha. The leading term cancels. This term doesn't cancel, so it's equal to 3 by 2. Okay, so this x unstable starts off at 3 when alpha is equal to 3 and then decreases monotonically to 3 by 2 when alpha is equal to infinity. Okay, so next thing we've learned, even stable circular orbits don't exist for every value of the radius. Even unstable circular orbits don't exist for every value of the radius. For r greater than 3 by 2 times the Schwarzschild radius, there are no circular orbits in the problem. When they're stable or unstable. This last fact is unimportant observation, right? Because nothing ever sits as an unstable circular orbit anyway. But it's sort of an interesting one. Okay? And the final thing that we interesting to do in this problem is to compute the energies of these central components. This is a very simple task, right? Because you just have to take this value here and plug that into effective potential square, and that gives you the energy square. Okay? So I'm not going to try to do the algebra on the board, I'll just tell you what the answer is. So there are no circuits. So remember the potentials. So, good. So, for R less than 3 by 2 RG, so suppose you start, that means you're always below this point. So you're always on this side of the curve. Okay, so there are two possibilities. You could be at a value such that this is the case, or you could be at the value such that your alpha is less than 3. In either case, it's qualitatively similar, because you're always on this side of the curve. So the orbits are just falling in. Falling into.
No, that's fine. You have set your orbits which for R between 3 and 3 by 2.
Between 3 and 3 by 2. Yes, unstable circuit.
Unstable circuit.
Yes.
What happens below 3 by 2?
Yes.
Unstable circuit orbits.
No, there are no circuit orbits. There are no stationary quantum.
Now, don't put back between 3 by 2.
Ah.
So what happens below that?
I didn't understand the question. What is the qualitative difference between what and what?
Between the orbits below 3 by 2
RG. There are no orbits below 3 by 2 RG.
So what happens?
The qualitative difference falls in. There are no stationary points in the effective potential. Okay? So, the effective potential could be of this form, or it could be of this form. In either case, the lowest minimum here never goes below 3 by 2. Never goes below, even this guy. So this point here never goes below 3 by 2 RG. So here, this point is never, if we call this beta is never smaller than 3 by 2. So if you start at 3 by 2 RG, okay, you can't be stationary. You have to fall. Or you have to go up with the velocity. But you can't sit stationarily below 3 by 2. There's no minimum below 3 by 2. Minimum, no extremum below 3 by 2. Is this clear? Okay. Good. So, just to complete this, let's quote the values of the energies. Well, I mean, sort of trivial. So the energy here is equal to m square root of 2 by r rg into 1 minus rg by r. And then you have to put in what r by rg is. This is just a mess. So just plugging in. What I've done is equate v squared over lambda. Equate v squared. And just plug in the solution path. Alpha was half range. Okay, plug that in. Okay? So you could, if you wanted to, find what the energies of the... at what energy you have this minimum circular... minimum stable circular orbit and so on. It turns out for the minimum stable circular orbit, E is equal to square root 8 by 9 m. Let's see if we can get that out of here. R by RG is 3. So this should be equal to m into 2 divided by, we pull an RG squared out here. what we should allow. Square root of 2 divided by 3 is to 1 minus 1 by 3. That's square root of 4 by 3. taking this formula. Okay, let me clear this up. I'll think about it and tell you. Okay, it's not worth spending time. Let me clear this up. I'll send you an email by the end of this class. Whether I think I know, I made a mistake. Most likely. Okay, there's some energy. I wasn't going to make any point about that. So there's some energy from the orbit, which one to compute. Okay, so this ends our discussion of massive particle motion in the Schwarzschild spectrum. Any questions or comments about it before we proceed? You know, you could ask, what do orbits look like when we're at radii near RJ? They'll look very weird because they come far from closing orbits. It was quite a miracle that for the 1 by r potential, orbits were closed. You go up and down in this radial effective potential, and by the time you've done that, we've gone through exactly 2 pi. So it was a miraculous property of the 1 by r potential, shared by almost no other potential in the world. It's not shared by this potential. So if you are orbiting in a quote-unquote elliptic manner, it won't be elliptic. In a quote-unquote elliptic manner, this potential, you have some very complicated orbit. Yeah, your orbit will go something like this. Keep going. We'll just keep. And there will be nothing particularly nice to say about it. You've got formulas for the orbit, computed for the motion, but you know, it's not like there's some other shape, other classical shape that replaces the ellipse, it's just some nice.
Delta
pi
is a multiple of pi,
multiple of pi minus. Yes, a delta function was any rational multiple of 2 pi, it would eventually close. But for generic values of parameters, that would not be the case. You remember we studied in the last part of our classical mechanics course how this extra conserved charge. You see, if it happens that delta phi is this one of this rational multiple, then there's some extra conserved charge in this problem, which distinguishes different orbits you could be on in phase space. It's having to do with that extra conserved charge in the problem, this Laplace-Runge vector that was there in the 1 by r potential, that generically is not there in this problem. Okay, so this will just be some mess. Okay.
So, for all this calculus,
near r equals 0 as well, it completely breaks down.
Yeah.
Right. Now, good. So, this is something we're going to study in some detail at some part in the course. You see, this metric looks like it's nonsensical at r equals rg. Actually, that's not the case. Okay. As we will see in some detail, what breaks down is the use of this particular coordinate system. Okay, below r equals rg. Physics is completely well defined. And actually, many of the conclusions that we would reach just using these formulas are also just going through for r less than rg. As we will see, but it requires some analysis to see, so I'm not going to try to explain that. The one thing I want to point out though is that everything we said about circular orbits was self-consistently outside of the equation. So all the conclusions we reached, for those conclusions we don't need to worry about that question. We come back to that. We plan to spend a whole 2 or 3 weeks on that. Okay. Okay. So we're almost there, you know. In today's lecture, I want to talk about the Landau-Lifshitz stress energy tensor. I want to talk about gravitational waves. But other than that, the remaining part of the course is on black holes and those questions. So, you know, for our basic general relativity, we're almost there. Okay. Good. So let's go on. What we have not studied so far is the motion of light.
What's the question?
In the Schwarzschild effect. So let's now move to the study of the motion of light in the Schwarzschild effect. The second classic test of general relativity, which may or may not have been a fraud test, but was about the deviation of light as it skimmed the surface of the sun. Okay? So let's first just start trying to compute that deviation. Okay. Now, we're going to use the same formulas as before, because we saw that from the point of view of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, the only difference between the motion of a massless and a massive particle is that you use the same Hamilton-Jacobi action, but set n equals 0. Okay, so that is one of the beautiful things about this Hamilton. Massless and massive particles in a democratic fashion. Okay, so let's once again write down the action with this time setting n equals 0. You remember we also spent a whole lecture on this, that the role of the action was actually played by the phase of the Klein-Gordon equation, the Maxwell equation to which your massless particle is the solution. Okay, there's a right action here, the right side. And then we've got minus something times t, and I call that omega, because that's what it is when it's a phase. The rate of change of phase with respect to time is an angular frequency. Just instead of calling it energy, it's very closely related to energy in quantum mechanics. H by times omega. Instead of calling it energy, I call it omega. Okay? Plus m times phi. M. And plus, let's call it psi r. Well, psi r was just the same formula as before. Was integral omega squared. By the 1 minus r g by r squared minus m squared by r squared plus, but no plus m squared. That's the whole point. Over 1 minus r g. Okay? So this is the action, the radial part of the action that describes the motion of a massless body in the Schwarzschild line. Okay. Now, let's try to. What we're interested in. Okay. Let's first look at. Just to get a sense for what's going on. Let's first look at Rg. Suppose Rg was equal to 0, then this is the motion of a massless particle in flat space. Okay? So we've got psi r is equal to integral omega squared minus m squared by r squared. Okay? And we're going to ask, can we solve this one? Of course, we should be able to solve for the motion in flat space. It would be a disaster if we couldn't. So, what do I mean by solve for the problem? I mean solve for the orbit. Solve for the motion of the particle. So, the motion is given by phi is equal to derivative of this one to n. So, it is equal to integral m divided by r squared. Square root of omega squared minus m squared by r squared. Okay. So we'll take this r squared out here and make this by r. Okay. Now, I'm going to do the following substitution. R is equal to m by omega times cos psi hat. Okay. This is the substitution that's going to work. Okay. So then what's dr? We get is m by omega cos square psi sine psi. The two minus signs can see. Minus. This is the sum. Let's call it theta. Nothing to do with it. Okay. Now, so plug that in. You see, the point of making substitution is that, did I do it the other way around? I should have had omega. Okay, so then what do we get? Let's see. So we get integral m divided by omega by m, and so m squared cos theta.
Definition goes to identity when m is 0, we'll also have that property. So this is not
is sufficient.
Yes.
Okay. Fine. So now we've been trying to work, including the first effects of the, including the first effects of the first non-trivial effects of the gravitation. Okay. So for that, as I got all these formulas, so for that, as we. As we did before when studying Maslow's quotient, we're going to try to make this change of coordinates that sets this to arise. So this m squared multiplies r to r minus r of g as before. So once again, it's a good idea to make the r minus r of g by 2 is equal to r prime. Well, once again, assuming that r of g is smaller than 2, your impact parameter. Okay, so I'm working the first order, the leading order, leading order with order like that. That's marks. Okay, so once again, this will become m squared by r prime squared. And what will this become? We've done it before, but let's do it again. This becomes the square root of omega squared divided by, that's right, this is r squared into r minus r of g squared minus m squared by r prime squared. Now, what's this? You see, this guy, r minus r of g is r prime minus r g by 2. But r is r prime plus r. So this is equal to integral omega squared into r prime plus r g by 2 squared over r prime minus r g by 2 squared minus m squared by r prime squared. Now what we'll do is to expand each of these and keep the limit. SR is equal to integral omega squared. So the leading term has just 1. The second term is what? Clearly is a factor of RG by R. You get a plus 1 from here because there's a by 2 but it's squared. And you get another plus 1 from here. It's minus by 2 it's squared. So plus 2. So plus omega squared 2 omega squared RG by R. The m squared, right? Okay. So the leading order, the radial part of the action, is given by that. Is this okay? Okay. Now what we want to do? What we want to do is the same as before. What we want to do is to the important point here is that we don't even need to keep the 1 by r squared pieces. If you remember, in our motion, in our analysis of orbital motion, we kept an additional piece. The precision of the perihelion of Mercury was proportional to rg squared. Because this trivial piece, I mean this piece, there was a trivial renormalization of the Newtonian attraction. Yeah, there was the Newtonian attraction, some trivial. But for the motion of light, Newtonian theory is silent about how it propagates. Okay? The most straightforward prediction would be that light is just not deviated. Okay? So any deviation at all is the first prediction, is the leading order effect in general. So we're just going to work the order RG. So, now what do we get? Well, if we want to see how much light bent, what we want to do is to find the correction to the free prediction of change in this angle phi is pi. Right? The straight line on the x-axis and phi changing by pi. What's the correction to that pi? Okay, so what we want is to compute. So let's first approximate this. So S of R is equal to integral omega squared minus m squared by R squared plus, now the derivative of this, 1 by omega squared minus m squared by R squared into half and 2 that cancels. So omega squared RG by R. to leading order. This is what this radial part of the action is. Okay? And here, everything's so simple that we don't need to resort to. Even there, it's quite simple. There's even less motivation to resort to tricks, so let's just do the integrals. So this is whatever it is. We've just computed the action. We've just computed what's necessary for the path. This is whatever it is. This is the interesting piece. This is the free straight line action. This is the interesting piece. So let's just compute that integral. So that integral, so delta SR is equal to omega squared R G divided by R. So that's divided by omega squared R squared minus M squared. Taking this denominator out inside. Okay, now this integral you all know. The way to get this integral is to make the substitution R is equal to. So let's first is equal to, let's take omega squared out. So R G divided by R squared minus M squared by omega squared. Now we make the substitution R is equal to M by omega cosh. Whatever. 1 omega remains. Thank you. So we make the substitution that that R is equal to M by omega cosh of an angle. And then when we make that substitution, we get a factor of M by omega out from here, but a factor of M by omega out in the measure as well. And then the two sine h's just cancel. Okay? So the solution is that delta SR is equal to RG omega times cos H inverse R divided by R omega. Making some choice of the intention. Okay? Right. So now that we've got this change in the action, in order to get the change in the angle, all we need to do is to differentiate this change in the action with respect to M and compare, look at what you get when you subtract what it is at the beginning and what it is at the end. The change in the angle will be twice the change in the angle to come to the minimum position. This. Okay, so we could the maximum position is, let's say, infinity. The minimum position is whatever the impact parameter is. Okay, so what we have to do is take this differentiated. So let's first differentiate. So del by del m or d by dm of delta sr is equal to what? Okay, is equal to what? So now we have to differentiate cos h. Let's remember how that works. So cos h theta is equal to alpha. So that alpha is equal to cos h plus theta. Then sin h theta e theta by d alpha. We get almost this expression. Yes. We get almost this expression, but we have to get 1 over x squared. Yes. Okay, yeah, okay, fine. So what Rakesh was saying, use what we know about the derivative of cos h, of the cos h inverse function. So cos h inverse is what? Is argument squared minus 1 over squared. Okay, good. So Pratyush's point is just to RG omega, then do argument squared minus 1 over argument squared minus 1. So R squared omega squared by M squared minus 1. And then into the derivative of this guy.
So that's R omega by M squared.
Okay, I hope you've done this right. So that's R G omega into R omega into R squared omega squared minus M squared, and then the whole thing right here. Okay, so if I've done this right, it's R G omega squared by M R divided by R squared.
Change it.
delta phi. Okay, now, this 2RG omega by n sounds like a strange answer. Because what we are interested in is what is the change in angle as a function of the impact parameter? You send a photon raising, okay? What is the change in angle as a function of the impact parameter? But we can use, sorry?
Impact parameter is there at
m. So what we want to do is to find what omega by m is in terms of impact parameter. Exactly. But we've already done that by computing what the free motion was in terms of omega. Can somebody read out what we have as the answer? R times cos pi would equal to what?
M.
This is the constant value of x, so this is the impact parameter. Okay, so impact parameter, let's call it b. Okay, so this then tells us that this is 2rg divided by b. This is an answer that makes sense. Impact parameter goes to infinity, we get 0. When impact parameter becomes like the Schwarzschild radius, it's very large. But if the impact parameter is small compared to the Schwarzschild radius, it's small dv. As large compared to the Schwarzschild radius, it's a small deviation. In the case of the sun, the Schwarzschild radius is something like 3 kilometers. Right? The radius of the sun is huge. Does anyone know the radius of the sun? 6,000 miles. That's how big the temperature is. What?
10 to the 8.
10 to the 8. Actually, I don't need to write this. Wait. The Earth's sun distance is 1.5 million kilometers. So Earth's sun distance is order 10 to the 8 kilometers. It's 1.5 into 10 to the 8. So I think it's less than 10 to the 8 kilometers. Maybe. Okay, it's something. It's something that's much bigger than 3 kilometers. Okay, if you put it in, you get some very small number. Some arc seconds, I'm not even terribly sure what an arc second is. Anyways, you get some arc seconds, and you compare that, and you get good movement on that. Okay? Excellent. So, fine. So, we've understood the motion of the grazing motion of light, almost non deviated motion of light in this background. I'll give you a little problem asking you to find, you know, where the light can go in orbit and things like that. The non-grazing motion of light in the Schwarzschild background. We won't spend time on it in class. Okay, unfortunately we've... Oh, there's one more thing I wanted to do. Every minute is a problem. I wanted to compute the absorption. Okay, let me just say this anyway. Okay, let me just say this. Okay, you know, in Newtonian motion, suppose you ask the question, what is the absorption cross-section of a point like mass? You've got a point like mass, you throw something at it. What is the absorption cross section? The cross section within which, if you throw it, it will be absorbed by the point. Do you remember we dealt with absorption cross sections in our classical mechanics course? Probability normalized by flux. Okay? What's the answer? If you have really a point like. So what is the cross-section that it will? You send something on from infinity, then it will be somehow captured. Good. Come on. This is the kind of question we ask in TIR interviews. Come, you know this. You just get general relativity is confused. What are the three kinds of motions for a Newtonian motion? The three kinds of geometric shapes. Traversed? Hyperbolic, parabolic, elliptic. If something starts at infinity, What kind of motion can it be? Can it be elliptic? No. Parabolic hyperbola. The parabolas and hyperbolas cannot capture them. So the absorption loss I can see is zero. In Newtonian motion, you throw something from infinity, it always comes back. Okay, now this is for point one. Of course, it could hit the earth in that state. It could, you know, be absorbed into the fire of the sun. That's kind of absorption. I mean, just a gravitational motion, there's no absorption loss actually. However, in general relativistic motion, that's no longer true. In general relativistic motion, if you throw something at the sun from infinity, it could get captured by the black hole. This is clear, right? The black hole is this region of space from which nothing can emerge. If you throw it near enough so that it gets captured by the black hole, it stays there. Okay? So, this is a big difference between general relativity and Newtonian physics. And one of the problems I wanted to work out here was to compute, you know, try to distinguish which trajectories of thrown from infinity would go and would be absorbed by the black hole, which ones would come back to infinity. Okay, but I'll just make this a problem. Okay, so let's say that we've completed our discussion of planetary motion in the general relativistic Schwarzschild background. There are a couple of things we'll have in the next problem set. One of this is motion of light, the motion of light. The other one is this absorption cross section. And another thing I'm going to ask you to do is the following. I'm going to ask you to write down just a Lagrangian for a point particle moving in the Schwarzschild background. And by varying that Lagrangian, obtain the equation solution. Okay? And then check that you get the same orbit equation, for instance. Okay? This is actually easier to do than to compute the geodesic equation, because that requires computing Christoffel's laws. This is just a simple variation, but actually very easy. It's a variation of square root ds. Okay? Just to give you a sense for these problems. Okay, and any other questions or comments? So the next class, what I'm planning, so next class on Thursday, what I'm planning to do is to discuss the Landau-Lushitz solutions, stress energy solutions. And then perhaps we talk about collapse before we make the collapse process. After which we talk about gravitational waves, and then black holes and cosmology. Okay, so we've come quite far in our course. You know, you should be. Please ask me questions about it. Things about the general structure of general relativity is not clear.